that's not a lot of time. You can't be pulsating five satellites down all at the same time because you just can't receive that much data in one ground station.
In your collection of data, is time synchronization important? And if so, what do you use as a common clock?
I believe, I didn't do a lot with clocking, but I believe they have one master clock, and then everybody is fed off of that clock.
How many of them have GPS receivers and they'll sync off GPS sensors?
Well, no, I was thinking more of studying the waves. Is it hits this satellite and this satellite, the time difference between them, you can tell the speed of the waves.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely, you can.
But again, you need to know the distance apart and the time.
Yep, and that's part of that communication back and forth between the two satellites, is it will give that data back and forth. Where am I in relationship to you? So it's a local reference, and then the master gives a global reference.
Okay. What are you using for frequency?
They work.
They work,
that's all I know.
I'm just curious, I'm using off-the-shelf radios.
Yes, they are using off-the-shelf radios.
MFJ.
That's an upgrade from Ramsey, though.
Mr. Papp has stepped down from Bowbank.
They are using off-the-shelf radios. I don't know which radio particularly they've settled on, which one worked better when they are in orbit. I know we've tried a couple of different ones. One of the really cool things about knowing how these radios will operate is we'll actually do a weather balloon flight test. We'll launch about 5 o'clock in the morning, and it'll go up. It'll take a bunch of data across the strip of Montana, and then you go chase it. Lands in the crazy mountain, but you better bring your pack here because it's going to be up 3,000 feet. Yes, that did happen once. We also had one drop into a cow pile. I do not think that
now. There are worse places.
There are worse places. What was cool about that is you had the radio, and then you had the, we call it APRS, APRS tracking beaconing signals, so that you could figure out where it was. The other thing that we did with those is we took pictures, because part of the science for that, you also have to have science with engineering, was to look at the curvature of the Earth, to be able to measure the radius of the curvature of the Earth based on weather balloon satellite images. I have those pictures, they should have been here. They're in the pod somewhere. A big shipping pod in my truck. I don't know how to start with that. That's how we verify and test that the radios are actually working and working properly.
Say when they launch a series of six of them up there, are they all deployed at the same time? Is it like a, you know, mechanically, how many, mm-hmm. are they like on a spring or
they're
something?
They're on a spring. Yep.
So they just pushed out.
Yeah, so there, this is a separating plate. You can see right here, this is the spring, and there's another spring down here. So you really just cram one in, you put a lid on it, you cram the other one in, you put a lid on it. And you launch them, you know, so many seconds apart based on, I mean, they're autonomously launched. So it's I'm going to wait 30 seconds, and the next one goes. Because at that point, you have no power, you have no data, you have no way of communicating where and when you want to launch. So it's all based on a clock that says so many minutes after the primary payload has gone, you get a little burst of energy that says start your countdown. You start your countdown from there, you launch your first one, that waits about maybe 2 minutes, and then you launch the second one. The first thing then that you do is you turn yourself on. Well, you have a fraction of the power that you need to, so it's emergency usage only. Get your batteries charged, get your solar panels on, and then you can start beaconing and say, yes, I'm alive.
So they don't launch fully charged?
Nope, you cannot launch fully charged. You have to launch as empty as you possibly can. One of our satellites was very, very quiet, so we couldn't hear it with our ground station. So we went down to SRI, Stanford Research Institute, and listened to it with the big dish. And I mean, big dish, that thing screams. station because we needed more power.
So these things are popping off on springs every minute or two. I mean, without enough drag, they just keep going out, right?
Yes. Yes, they keep going on the path that they're launched, which is why after this gets released, you turn around and reorientate yourself to the magnetic bands of the Earth, because all of your satellites are passive attitude controlled, so they all have torque coils in them somewhere. Some are running in the middle, some are running on the sides, and based on where you want to point yourself, you fire up a torque coil and you orient yourself with the normal down to Earth.
But the other thing you're thinking of is that these things aren't just literally just spring and they're never going to come back. The amount of energy imparted, the speed increase imparted from one of these springs is infinitesimal compared to the amount of energy it took to get it into orbit. So that spring is not responsible.
It's like 10 pounds of force.
Right. Not responsible for coming down. The other interesting thing is that recently they put one of those cubesat launchers on the station. And so on resupply missions, they'll send up a cartload of those things. Astronauts just chuck them out the window.
That's gonna be fun.
Chuck them out the window.
Pretty much.
So they
That'll
be the airlock window.
They launch three at a time, so there's three jack in the boxes on here on the lower fairing. And so you launch three and then you wait and then you launch three. Now the challenge is when you have six working satellites all within close range, you don't really know who's who. So that's another challenge too, is how do you know which beacon you're actually listening to? There were times where some of the clusters were so close, we couldn't tell if we were listening to Minnesota's or ours. Turns out we were listening to ours, but Minnesota claimed it as theirs because theirs was dead. Sorry guys, it doesn't work like that.
So you don't have any IDs or IDs?
Does Colorado track all those? We keep track of them for future launches from the white collisions?
NORAD does.
Yes,
until they burn up
into
orbit.
You mentioned early on you made some prototypes, but you didn't have a NASA license to make ones that could. What's the rationale that, is that just a skill thing? They don't want to have something up there that's working?
Yeah, you have to have different certifications. For instance, at NASA, you have to be certified to change a light bulb. No, I'm not kidding.
You're kidding, right?
No, I am not kidding. We actually had a safety class that says, this is how you change a light bulb. This is how you place a ladder. This is how you unscrew a light bulb safely.
This is why they can't get anything done anymore.
Exactly.
This is why the blue white toilet seat costs $6,000.
Exactly.
I think I want to go down there and be a janitor.
You probably would. So what it says is that it's not so much it's a NASA certification thing, as it's a national board certification thing. There's your professional engineer, and then there's your new apprenticeship, and then you do, I forget what, after the professional engineer, fundamentals of engineering, then professional engineering. So if you don't complete your professional engineering coursework, you're not recognized by the NASA community as a precision machinist. And I only passed my fundamentals because I didn't want to sit through another technologist.
Have you had any dealings with the Morehead State University in Kentucky?
Yes.
Space science program?
We did have a collaboration with KU. We actually stole some of their engineers for grad school because they decided they didn't want them anymore. They're actually very smart. Sort of redneck-y people, but we'll forgive them for that.
But they play great music.
Wow. And they also have good taste in whiskey.
They also have a really nice brown station.
They do have a very nice ground station. Unfortunately, all of their money went into their ground station and none of their money went into functional satellites. So
four launch, I think, before they turned the system into the ground station.
Yeah.
They had some launch, I know.
They had some launch, but they had a lot of launch failures. Were they the Tiger Sat? I don't remember what their satellites were. but
I was much more interested in their 27 meter dish.
Yes. Like I said, they spent a lot of money on their ground station and did not really think about functional satellites. And that happened with a lot of universities early on, is they put together, you know, this kind of hodgepodge satellite that they thought would work, and they didn't really test it, and they didn't really understand end-to-end testing, which, interesting story, by the way, is why the Hubble doesn't actually work, because they didn't do a functional end-to-end test.
Well, they fixed it. Well, yes, but they
aligned the optic with the screw behind it and not the plate of the glass.
Which is why they had to go and fix it.
Yeah. I actually met that guy. He still has his job, believe it or not.
Literally needed to put glasses on.
Yeah, so they had to put glasses on it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which is why the James Webb is really, really cool. You know, pounds force and pounds mass is not the same thing. The Viking rover can attest to that. And Transformers kind of got it wrong.
This is why scientists should lead it up to the engineers.
Well, this is true, but you have to have scientists to actually do the science, because if you leave the engineers to test engineering data in space, nobody will ever fly. Because apparently engineering data is not relevant. I actually don't know anymore. I lost touch of the Minnesota community back in 2008 when I went down to grad school. I know the University of Arizona still had a very active program up until 2012 when they launched Phoenix. And then they switched everything over to Mars-based research instead of CubeSat-based research. So the major players left are University of New Hampshire, Montana State University, Penn State, and Cal College.